Hello, my dear students. Now, the part 2 of the general anatomy joints lecture, that is diarthrosis. Diarthrosis are the movable joints. They are also known as the cavitated joints or the synovial joints. They are involved in the locomotion purpose. They have got special characteristics for the locomotion purpose. Look at this diagram. This diagram shows us a cavitated joint. The cavity is formed by capsule that converts the contact between two bones into a cavity. You can also note down inside the capsule we have got a synovial membrane here. This is the synovial membrane. You can note down that contact between two bones has got a cartilage. I'll shortly explain all these characteristics. So always remember, the synovial joints, cavitated joints and the diarthrosis joints are used for locomotion purpose. First of all, I will explain the concept of the capsule. Why there is a capsule in the synovial joints, in the movable joints. Look at here, these are two bones making contact, making a joint. And this area is surrounded by a capsule which converts this area into a cavity. The functions of the capsule are very much important. It provides mechanical support and it serves as a barrier between the external and the internal environment. But why this barrier is important? Because nothing wrong should come inside the joint cavity. Here we got no debris, no dust. We want a clean environment here for the sake of excellent mobility. Now look at these two diagrams here. These are the ball bearings covered with the help of a metal plate. Suppose this is a capsule that has converted this cavity into a closed cavity. And you can easily understand what is the function of a closed cavity. There should be no dust inside and we can avoid the leakage of the lubricant here. So this is the function of the capsule. Look at this diagram of an automobile. This is the joint of an automobile which has been covered with the help of a capsule. You can note down here, inside are the joints for the mobility purpose and they are covered with the help of a capsule. Why they are covered? Simply because we don't want anything wrong inside the joint cavity. So this is the purpose of the capsule. Now I will explain the concept of articular surface. The concept of articular surface is very much important for your cross anatomy joints. Keep in mind, this is the elbow joint and this is the wrist joint. For the description of the articulation, always keep in mind you have to be very precise what are the part of the bone that actually participate in the movement. What are the part of the bone that actually in contact with each other during the articulation. You know, this is the trochlea and this is the capitulum. Trochlea articulate with the trochlear notch of the ulna and radius articulate with the radial head superior aspect, not the circumference. I will repeat, when you are asked about the articulation at the elbow joint, you will say that trochlea articulate with the trochlear notch and capitulum articulate with the head of radius superior aspect, not the circumference. So the other parts, this coronoid fossa, this radial fossa are not involved in articulation. So you have to be very precise when you are mentioning the articular surfaces. Articular surfaces are the surfaces that are in contact actually. These are the articular surfaces. These are not the articular surfaces. Look at here. This is the wrist joint made by the radius bone and the carpal bones. But when you are asked about the articulation, you will say that radius, lower and inferior aspect participate in articulation, not the anterior aspect, not the lateral, medial or posterior aspect. Only the inferior aspect of the lower end of the radius participate in articulation. So this is the concept of the articular surfaces. Now the concept of the lining cartilage only over articular surface. I have explained you what is articular surface. Now I will explain that articular surfaces are lined by the cartilage. This cartilage is most of the time hyaline cartilage, but sometimes it is fibrocartilage. But what is the lining cartilage? Here you can see that this is the articular surface. the part of the bone that is actually in contact with each other. But this part of the bone, you can see that is lined by an extra covering, that is the hyaline cartilage. Why this extra covering is important? Look at here. This is a shiny ball bearing and this is an old ball bearing. What you think is good for mobility, good for free movement? Definitely this one, which has got a shiny surface, this is good for mobility, this is good for the joint. So that's why it's important that two bones make a contact with each other, and for the sake of the mobility, they must have a shiny surface, they must have a freely movable surface, that is made possible with the help of the cartilage, hyaline cartilage and the fibrocartilage. Look at this picture here. This is the knee joint. The knee joint is joined between femur bone and the tibia bone. These are the condyles of the femur bone, which articulate with the top surface of the tibia bone. This is a joint. These are the articular surfaces. Here you can see that articular surfaces which are in contact with each other have got an extra covering, and the extra covering is the hyaline cartilage. And the purpose of the hyaline cartilage is excellent mobility. In these pictures, you can also note down that the articular surfaces are lined by hyaline cartilage, which are in contact with each other. The part of the bone that is not in contact with each other is not lined by the hyaline cartilage, the lining cartilage. So keep in mind, only the articular surfaces are lined by the hyaline cartilage. There is no cartilage over the non-articular parts. There is no cartilage. Now the concept of the synovial membrane. Why synovial membrane is important for the diarthrosis joint, and the joint is named as synovial joint. Why synovial membrane is so much important? Look at here. This is the bone. This is the bone. They make contact with each other, and then this contact area is covered with the help of a capsule to form a cavity. This is a closed cavity. Inside of the capsule is lined by a delicate synovial membrane. Inside the capsule, inside the cavity, there is a synovial membrane in the form of a pouch, and this synovial membrane secretes synovial fluid inside the joint cavity. What is the purpose of the synovial fluid inside the cavity? Look at here. This is the function of the synovial fluid. The synovial fluid is a lubricant, which minimizes the friction between the two bones when they come in contact with each other and when we move. The synovial fluid is important for lubrication. Keep in mind. Now I'll add some more important facts about the synovial membrane. This is the capsule. It is made up of the dense connective tissue. Dense connective tissue means this capsule has got some strength. Now inside of the capsule is lined with the synovial membrane. Synovial membrane has got no strength. It is delicate. It is made up of very thin connective tissue, very delicate connective tissue makes up the synovial membrane, and the synovial membrane secretes fluid inside the cavity. So this is a combination of strong capsule outside and inside a delicate synovial membrane in the form of a pouch. Now explain the concept of bursa that is derived from the synovial membrane. What is synovial membrane? Bursa. Look at this diagram. This is the stress ball, and when we apply the pressure, the bubbles, the pouches come out of these gaps. When we increase pressure inside the pouch, the small pouches protrude out. This is the concept of the synovial membrane and a bursa. Now look at here. We already know that inside the capsule, we have got a pouch of the synovial membrane, which is a delicate structure. We have got a synovial membrane here. It's a delicate structure present here. If there is a gap in the capsule, the synovial membrane will protrude out, and there will be a small pouch outside the capsule. And outside the capsule, protrusion of the synovial membrane in the form of a pouch is known as bursa. Now what are the functions of the bursa? Look at the diagram. This is the diagram of the knee joint. Here we have got the skin, and this is the bone, the tibia bone. Here we have got the tendon of the muscle. This is the femur bone. These are the other muscle getting attached over the bone, and this is a ligament. Now when we will move our knee joint during movement, you can see that there can be friction between skin and patella. There can be friction between this tendon and the femur bone. There can be friction between these three tendons and the joint ligaments. There can be friction between the two bones. So dealing with all these type of frictions during movement between the skin and the bone, between the bone and the bone, between the basal tendon and the bone, between the tendon and the tendon, between the tendon and the ligaments, providing all these frictions, the answer is bursa. Look at here. This is a bursa between the tendon and the bone. This is a bursa between the skin and the bone. This is a bursa between the tendons. This is a bursa between the tendon and the skin. This is the bursa again with the tendon and the bone. So wherever there is the chance of friction, we will have a bursa, and bursa is the outpouching of the synovial membrane. Look at here. This is the acromion process. This is the conopoid process. This is the head of the humerus bone. And humerus bone head forms a joint with the glenoid cavity of the scapula bone. This is shoulder joint. When we perform abduction, the greater tubercle and the acromion process come close to each other. There is another structure that passes from the superior aspect of the humerus head and is attached over the greater tubercle. That is the tendon of the supraspinatus muscle. So now look at here, when we perform abduction here, there is a chance of friction between the tendon and the bones. Note down, during the abduction, there is a chance of friction between the tendon and the bone. For preventing this, we have got bursa here, that is the subacromial bursa that prevents the friction. But keep in mind, bursa has its limits. Excessive and repetitive abduction during the sport will lead to the injury to the tendon, will lead to the inflammation of the tendon, that is known as the rotator cuff tendinitis. Now the concept of communicating and non-communicating bursa. Bursa can be communicating, can be non-communicating. Let me explain. This is the capsule of a joint. Inside we have got a synovial membrane. But here is the gap. So the synovial membrane will protrude out. So the synovial membrane will protrude out. So this is a bursa and this is a bursa. During development, it happens that the gap closes again. If the gap will close again, you can easily understand there will be no connection between the bursa outside and the synovial membrane, synovial cavity inside. There will be no connection. So this bursa is the non-communicating bursa. But if during development the gap doesn't close, then the outside bursa will have an open communication with the inside bursa. The cavity here will communicate with the cavity inside. Inside is the synovial fluid, here is the synovial fluid. So this is the type of the communicating bursa. This is also clinically important. If there is an infection in the communicating bursa, the infection will spread inside the main joint cavity. But if there is infection in the non-communicating bursa, this infection cannot go inside. Now look at here. This is again the diagram of knee joint. This is the synovial pouch and these are the bursa. Now try to locate the communicating bursa and non-communicating bursa. You can see that this bursa is not communicating with the main synovial cavity. So this is non-communicating bursa. This bursa is also not communicating with the main cavity. This is non-communicating bursa. This is the non-communicating bursa. But what about this bursa? Now I will quickly repeat what I have mentioned so far. These are two bones which make a contact with each other. And the contact is known as the articular surface. And the articular surfaces are lined by hyaline cartilage. Only the articular surfaces are lined by hyaline cartilage. This is the capsule which converts the site of contact into a cavity. Inside the strong capsule, we have got a delicate synovial membrane. We have got a delicate synovial membrane which will secrete synovial fluid inside, which is a lubricant which will minimize the friction between the two bones for good mobility. And if we have a gap in the capsule, the synovial membrane will protrude out. This is the bursa. If the gap will close, the bursa will be non-communicating. If the gap in the capsule doesn't disappear, then this bursa is communicating. It will communicate with the inside cavity. Now I'll talk about the articular disc. What is an articular disc or intra-articular disc? The intra-articular disc is present between the two bones that are in contact. This is a disc, intra-articular disc. This disc divides the joint cavity into two parts. This disc is made up of the fibrocartilage. Wherever we have an articular disc, there will be an important change. Keep in mind, when we have an articular disc inside the joint cavity, there will be an important change, and the change is the lining cartilage, which was hyaline cartilage most of the time. But when there is intra-articular disc, the lining cartilage will change. We will have a fibrocartilage. So keep in mind, wherever we have an articular disc, the lining cartilage will not be hyaline cartilage. It will be fibrocartilage. Now look at here. This is the temporomandibular joint between the mandible bone and the temporal bone. This is the temporomandibular joint. Here we've got a cartilage. It divides the joint cavity into a superior compartment and an inferior compartment. Here I will show you an important function of the articular cartilage. You can note down here, the superior articular surface is like this. In routine, when we have a superior articular surface like this, the inferior articular surface is also reciprocal. But in this case, we don't have a reciprocal inferior surface. The inferior surface is like this. This is the mandibular condyle. You can note down that there is no alignment between the two opposite surfaces. How they will articulate? For solving this problem, we have got the articular cartilage. The shape of the articular cartilage is like this. Inferiorly, it fits into the lower bone, and superiorly, it fits into the upper bone. So now the problem is solved with the help of the articular disc. It is approximating the lower convex surface with its concave side. This is convex, this is concave, but this side is concave and convex. So the disc is also concave and convex. This is the special function of the disc and the temporomandibular joint. Now look at here. This is the manubrium of the sternal bone. This is the clavicle bone and this is the first rib. There is a joint between the sternum and the clavicle which is known as the sternoclavicular joint, and you can see that in the joint cavity, we have got a disc, and the disc divides the joint cavity into two parts. This is also an example of the articular disc, the sternoclavicular joint. Now I'll talk about the meniscus. What is a meniscus? Look at here. In the knee joint, between the two articular surfaces, we have got these C-shaped meniscus. This meniscus has got elevated ends over the periphery, and towards the center, the ends are tapering. So in the cross section, this will look like this. Let me draw the meniscus here. Between the two articular bones, we have got a fibrocartilaginous meniscus. The meniscus is made up of a fibrocartilage. This is the meniscus here. Its ends are attached to the non-articular parts of the tibia bone. This is the meniscus. Why we want meniscus in the knee joint? With the help of this picture, you can note down the femur condyle precisely fit into the lower surface with the help of meniscus. The other function of the meniscus is that it is a shock absorber. Because knee joint is a weight bearing joint, and during running, during jumping and during other physical activities, we want a spring between the two bones, and that spring is the meniscus, which is made up of the fibrocartilage. Again, look at this diagram. We have got two condyles of the femur and then the tibia upper surface for the articulation of the knee joint, and over the tibia superior surface we have got meniscus. These meniscus deepen the area for the better adjustment of the condyles. Here I will explain what is a labrum and what are its functions. Look at here, this is the shoulder joint between the glenoid cavity and the spherical head of the humerus. There is a problem. The problem in this ball and socket joint is that the ball is big and the socket is small, which is not good for the stability and the movement. For solving this problem, we add an extra surface here. For adding an extra surface here, this is the labrum, which increases the depth of the socket. For increasing the depth of the socket, we have got the labrum. Look at this diagram of the shoulder joint. Only the scapular side is shown. This is the glenoid fossa, which is not sufficient for the ball-shaped head of the humerus. For deepening this glenoid fossa, we add an extra structure. Now the cavity is deepened. First the cavity was like this, now the cavity is like this. So this is the labrum, which has deepened the socket. Now look at here, this is the hip joint. Another example of the ball and socket joint. This is the ball shaped head of the femur that fits into the acetabulum. But again, the socket is insufficient and we have to add an extra area. The extra area is added with help of the labrum. This is the actual acetabular cavity and here we have added the acetabular labrum. In the hip joint, the labrum is known as the acetabular labrum. In the shoulder joint, the labrum is known as the glenoid labrum. The function is, it adds up the surface area. It deepens the socket. With the help of this skeleton, I will explain when a joint is known as simple joint, when a joint is known as compound joint, and when a joint, a synovial joint, is known as complex joint. These are the three categories of the synovial joints, simple, compound, and complex. This is very simple. If the joint is between two bones, for example, the shoulder joint is between scapula and humerus, two bones, then this is the simple joint. If joint is between more than two bones, look at here, the elbow joint between humerus, between ulna and the radius, there are three bones, the joint will be compound joint. The complex joint is the joint when inside the cavity of the joint we have got an articular disc, or inside the cavity of the joint we have the meniscus. In case of the articular disc and the meniscus, the joint will be labeled as complex. Doesn't matter it is contact between two bones or more than two bones. It's a simple joint or a compound joint. It doesn't matter. If there is a disc, if there is a meniscus, then the joint is complex joint. And the example is knee joint. Example is sternoclavicular joint. Example is temporomandibular joint. Because these joints has got a disc and a meniscus.